Well, good evening, everyone, and on behalf of the entire University of Bristol family, it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the Great Hall this evening to this, the sixth annual Mayor's Lecture. It's a very special evening, as you know, in the city's rich calendar of civic events. When I first arrived in Bristol just over 3 years ago, it seems like yesterday, I was attracted to the university not just because of its international reputation for excellence in education and research, but also because of its reputation as one of Europe's great civic universities. And as you know, the university was founded over a century ago because the citizens of the city at that time foresaw the importance of universities as catalysts for growth and development of successful city regions. And today, the university is the region's, I think, largest employer of over 7,000 people and contributing over 1 billion annually to the local economy. But even more than that, the university is now partnering with the city, its citizens and organizations across a wide range of activities, of education and research, of course, but also healthcare, volunteering, arts and culture, and support of both local enterprises and large multinationals. And given the amount of political and economic uncertainty in the world, we see it as a priority to raise our sights even higher as a civic university. And nowhere is that more evident than in our plans for the new Temple Quarter Enterprise campus at the heart of what should be one of Europe's largest urban transformation projects. Our Temple Quarter campus will allow us to support our academic ambitions, future-proofing our university so we can compete with the very best in the world over the decades ahead. But equally important, our new campus is giving us an opportunity to create new partnerships and to create a really valuable, high-quality resource for citizens, for community groups, for cultural organizations, and for the local business community. And we're thrilled that so many of you in the room tonight have already engaged with that conversation, helping us shape that new campus. And I hope many more of you will do so over the weeks and months ahead. And we're delighted that one of the very talented individuals that we have commissioned to work with us on our vision for the Temple Quarter Enterprise Campus is Vanessa Kusule, who has followed in the footsteps of Miles Chambers to become Bristol's second city poet. Many of you will know Vanessa. She's already an exciting and accomplished writer and performer. She was the recipient of the prestigious Leverhulme Arts Scholarship from the Bristol Old Vic. She's worked with the South Bank Centre, with RADA, with Knee High Theatre and Warner Music, and has had her work featured on the BBC, The Guardian, The Huffington Post, Sky TV, and TEDx, to name but a few channels. Her poetry collections, Joy Riding the Storm and A Recipe for Sorcery, are both published by Burning Eye. So buy them and read them. Please join me in welcoming Vanessa to the podium.
Oh, there's loads of you. Okay. Can I have this water? Is this, bear with me, folks. All in a day's work. This is amazing to be here, if not incredibly daunting. And Bristol City Poet is quite the title to have, much like any role where you are supposed to represent an entire city. I think it is very difficult and potentially impossible. I'm trying my best. I'm trying to make sure that I cover as many parts of the city as possible and hear as many stories as I can, but I inevitably have my own lens, my own perspective. My relationship with Bristol is that I came here 9 years ago as a student. I graduated in this building, and I fell in love with it, so I stayed. And I have a very rose-tinted relationship with the city, but I think it's important as the poet representing Bristol to understand that there are people that have a lot of frustrations with the city, that have lived here 2-3 times longer than me and have seen it change a lot, perhaps in ways that are uncomfortable or not beneficial. And I feel a duty to represent that as openly and as non-judgmentally as possible. So this is a poem that I wrote to attempt to address the good and the bad and to just hold the dissonance of these two things with grace, because I think so often we want to either hear all the good things or all the bad things. We can't seem to accept that, you know, it's usually just a heady mix of the two. So this is called A Tale of Two Cities, after the Charles Dickens novel. It's an attempt to give a full picture of Bristol as I see it, and hopefully a few of you see it. This will be a tale of two cities, academic mecca where students gather, cheap drinks flow down gullets, freedom never tasted so neon. The just ripe fruit of friendship, abundant and brilliant, the next generation's innovators incubate here, seeking lifelong union with knowledge and brief affairs with basics vodka. Well, that was me, at least. But also anxieties rise with expectations and tuition fees. Not everyone finds like minds or takes to the ritual oblivion of pub crawls and club nights. Some feel the long shadow of loneliness hang over them. They face a future clear as fog. This will be the tale of two cities, the home place of St. Paul's Carnival. Polish shops sit between falafel joints and Caribbean takeaways, all share square footage and cultural clout. White boys wear Aladdin pants and say Wagwan, lilting from patois to West Country by way of home counties. But we are not a true melting pot. More at ease with foreign food and music than people. We're the most segregated city in the country. The divides of money, class, and colour are the true soundtrack bubbling underneath that well-worn Bob Marley tune. This will be the tale of two cities. Popular metropolis that so many flock to, blessed respite from breeze-block cities that are all commerce and concrete but no heart. Drunk on hope, people up sticks and start again here, in a city with a seemingly endless embrace. But Bristol's long-standing residents pay for this success story. Newcomers price many out of areas they once called home. The landscape morphs to a slick cityscape. An inevitability, a travesty, depends on who you ask. Old timers make an earnest cry to make Bristol shit again. This will be the tale of two cities, where pop-ups and independent restaurants reign, eclectic morsels for eager mouths, where the mezze at Baba Ganoush on St. Nicholas Road could make a grown man weep with gratitude. I haven't been paid to say that. It's just true. Anyone who's been there knows, all right? Every corner boasts something to make palates sing and waistbands pucker. But on the outskirts of this excess sits Hartcliffe. Residents face a 20-minute walk up a fierce hill for a basic grocery shop. Fresh food not a given, but a luxury. A piece of fruit either out of reach or out of pocket. This will be the tale of two cities. But which do we tell? Both belong to us and must be told in their entirety. Wearing the pride and the shame on each shoulder, we walk forward, knowing with hard work one of those forces might just outshine the other. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vanessa, and thank you for all the work you're doing as our city poet. It's a delight to work with you, and you look forward to many more poems to come. We're going to run two short films now. The first is called Voices of the City, and the second is Future Bristol. Now, the second, I should point out, is a sneak preview of it's not quite finished yet, but it's a sneak preview of a new film which will be available later this year. But we thought this was a good opportunity to show you some of the thinking of the city and the very creative way that this has been put forward in the film. So we're going to have that, and then coming to the stage straight afterwards will be our mayor, Marvin Rees. Thank you very much.
people, and people here have got so much energy and so many ideas. When I go out and about, even in the most disadvantaged community, you find people that have got things that they want to make happen, and they can do that in Bristol.
There's a willingness of communities to come together, to buck the mainstream, and to do things which are in the interest of the communities they represent.
What I really love about Bristol are the people of Bristol, who are just so fantastic, and the energy that's created in Bristol. And I think the most important thing is that Bristol is full of surprises, and you're always going to find something new.
It's a place of transformation. It gives the opportunity to kind of stretch your wings and try things, and probably because, you know, there isn't that much level of resource in many ways, so you have to be a bit DIY. But it gives you a chance to stretch out and become a different person, or at least explore those different parts of yourself.
It's such a young city. It's got a real buzz about it. There's loads and loads of students around. It's very exciting, it's very stimulating.
It's full of good people who care. Bristol's a place where striving for equality matters.
I just think it's a vibrant, amazing, warm city that allows you to really find your place. In terms of the work that I do, I couldn't choose any other place to work. And I think that's basically because of Bristol's history of activism, radicalism. You don't have to conform.
I think there's so many opportunities out there that anyone can access, and there's so many different things for everyone.
Everything's really close together. I can walk everywhere, enjoy the green spaces, and it feels like a nice place to live.
Extraordinarily diverse city, 91 different languages. Just the way that we see those different cultures coming together, I think is really very special.
We've got so much more confidence, we're so much more ambitious, and we're so much more aligned around the various different stakeholders.
It just has so much to offer, both, you know, for people who work here and live here. So I have three boys who I've brought up through a great education system. We have a load of green parks. There's a great art and cultural tradition here with which I can bring them up and share. There's a fantastic restaurant culture. And all in all, I think it's a very, very vibrant and safe city in which to live and work.
The vibrancy of the urban spaces, but I think, like everybody, I really enjoy the cool green spaces as well, the Downs, great people.
It's fabulous for raising children. It's got some of the best schools in the country. It's also very safe and has a community feel to it. So I feel that I can bring up my children in a community environment, in a safe place, and still give them the best academic opportunity that would get them set up for the future.
Bristol is a great place to live because it's got great people. It's got a powerful history, it's got a good sense of culture, it's got soul, but at the same time, it's more than energy.
What excites me is the opportunity, perhaps a unique one, to see a city transformed, a city coming together and everybody having their potential realised and contributing to the future of the city.
So I think it's a city that can be a beacon. You know, what a modern, diverse city can look like in terms of being a city for all its citizens.
There is so much planned to happen. So through the One City plan, I think we're going to become a fairer and more equal city, and that excites me.
I see so many inspiring and future projects that I think are going to happen, and I'm really excited to see the outcomes of those for young people in Bristol.
I think Bristol has great potential for the future because we have strong city partnerships. We have two brilliant universities full of thinkers. We have clever women and men. We have an entrepreneurial spirit. And I think if we bring all those things together, we could be looking at possibilities for a radical social infrastructure project fit for the 21st century that has caring and nurturing for humans and our environment at the centre of what we do.
The youth in Bristol is really imaginative and has got a lot of ideas that they can bring to the city, and I think when they get their time, it will be an amazing place to live.
What excites me about Bristol's future is, of course, the energy that we've got means that we're innovative, we're creative, and that's going to take us to places that we can't even dream about yet.
Bristol is a fantastic city to be in if you're working in the creative sector, and what I think is really exciting is it's going to become an even more fantastic place. There is a huge movement now out of London West in terms of money and talent into this city, and Bristol over the next 10 or 15 years is without doubt going to become one of the most significant media cities in the country.
What excites me about Bristol's future is our journey as a city to become a truly world-class city, and our recognition that we've got both the economic and the social capital to do so.
For the first time, a willingness of different groups within the city to come together to consider how we best get the resources of the city to tackle issues in a new and collaborative way.
Being a member of the City Funds Board, one of the things that we're committed to doing is to think about innovative ways to make the city a better place to live.
We have real ambitions, we have a real sense of purpose. Many of the stakeholders in the city are really aligned to getting the job done, whether that's working to tackle the inequalities that we have, whether that's about creating the best place for Bristol to thrive from a business perspective, but fundamentally making it the best place for citizens and really helping to improve quality of life.
There's a great drive to be the best that Bristol can be. We're ambitious for the city and ambitious for its future.
Summing up Bristol in three words is quite difficult to do, but if you were going to push me, I guess I would say vibrant.
Creative.
Ambitious.
It's tolerant.
Cultural.
Quirky.
Opportunities.
Communities.
Confident.
Alternative.
Innovative.
Entrepreneurial.
Diverse.
Fairness.
Resilient.
Inspiring.
Social inclusion.
Dynamic.
City of hope.
Beautifully complex.
And lush.
In the coming years, Bristol will see billions of pounds of investment, bringing development on an unprecedented scale. The ageing road network at the Western Harbour will be redesigned, freeing up land for up to 3,500 new homes in the heart of the city. Plans are progressing to deliver a new urban quarter across five sites in Bedminster, including more than 1,000 homes. A thriving city centre is a vital part of Bristol's future success. Work is underway to ensure that the centre provides the homes, offices, leisure and retail spaces that people need. On land beside the M32 in the city centre, the council is developing plans for up to 250 new homes and business space, which would create more than 100 new jobs. And in the Temple Quarter, ongoing regeneration will bring up to 11,000 new homes, over 22,000 new jobs, and a brand new 300 million university campus for Bristol. Developments such as Engine Shed 2 will provide space for growing businesses to expand, while the transformation of Bristol Temple Meads will prepare the city to receive up to 22 million rail passengers a year by 2030 and provide new retail, work and leisure spaces. New options for Temple Island could bring 2,000 new jobs and boost the economy by more than 900 million. Across the city, a massive programme of house building is underway. In Loch Lees, a 178 million programme will deliver 800 new and affordable homes across five sites. Work to deliver new homes, employment space and community facilities in South Bristol is also progressing. Outline plans for 1,500 homes, a high quality park, employment and education space at Hengrove were submitted in June. If approved, this will represent the city's largest regeneration scheme in a generation. Hundreds of other sites across the city are also being released for housing development, putting the council on track to exceed its target to deliver 2,000 new homes a year by 2020. Connecting all these developments with Bristol Centre and employment areas is critical to the success of the city. That's why partners in the West of England are pressing ahead with plans for a mass transit system that will reduce congestion and pollution, creating a cleaner, greener, more connected city for the future. It's an ambitious vision, and Bristol certainly has the energy, creativity, and drive to make it a reality.
A lot of people here. Well, thanks for coming out this evening. Really appreciate you making the time. And I suppose there's two things I just want to start with. One was just talk about our city poet. And I think in what you heard this evening, you really get a sense of what we're trying to, what we hoped would come from a city poet. Someone who really captures the soul of the city. And I love that piece about, you know, things are rarely one or the other. Often things are messy and we hold contradictory truths and descriptions of a place together at the same time. And that's one of the things that we have to contend with, something that politics struggles to work with. And I also this evening have to say happy birthday to Bristol Cultural Development Partnership, which is 25 years old this year, and which makes these events possible. So for the past 25 years, we've worked with the Arts Council England, Business West, University of Bristol, and the University of the West of England in developing cultural projects across the city. And I'm sure you'll agree, it's a huge contribution to what we are, the way we work, and engaging people in the meaningful questions of our city at this time. So, someone clapping them, not me. That wasn't scheduled in, but there you go. I'm used to that now, things are not scheduled. So I really appreciate the chance to have this annual address because it's a really important moment in the year because it's my opportunity to talk and connect directly with the city. This evening, I want to cover the progress we've made over the last 2 years, show you how we have delivered on our pledges and set out the aspirations we've been growing for Bristol. I'd also like to take a little bit of time to share some personal reflections on the quality of political activism, debate, and commentary that the city of Bristol is subjected to. But let me start with a bit about Bristol City Council. Because in September, we opened our doors to a local government association peer challenge. We wanted an objective and expert assessment of the council undertaken at the midpoint of my administration. Now, the team they sent was drawn from across the country. It was made up of Labour and Conservative councillors and senior local authority officers and staff from the local government association. They spent more than 460 hours talking with over 200 people, including staff, local and national partners, and even opposition councillors. In the executive summary of their report, which will be published in the coming weeks, they said, Bristol City Council is laying the foundations to underpin its improvement journey. The ambitious and collaborative leadership the Mayor has shown for the city is warmly welcomed by the Council's partners. Bristol City Council has recently appointed a new senior officer leadership team, which collectively has the potential to set a positive direction for the Council's workforce. 2 years ago, the Council was facing a funding crisis and commissioned an external review to assess its root causes and make recommendations to address them. 2 years on, the council's financial management and grip is stronger. They also say the sense of ambition for Bristol as a city is clearly evident, and many stakeholders we spoke to talked variously about their hope and optimism for the future. Now, to appreciate the significance of these findings, I must remind you of where we were just 2 years ago. When I arrived at City Hall in May 2016, I knew there'd be challenges. The council had earned a reputation of non-delivery. We were taking charge under a government committed to austerity, and Brexit was on the march. I was, however, hopeful and committed to delivering the fresh approach the city needed. I mean, after all, why stand for election unless you know you can bring improvement? But no one could have anticipated the organisational dysfunction we were inheriting. The scale of the challenge was set out in the review we commissioned into the council governance and finance after we'd found a £30 million hole in the budget. We commissioned an expert and objective assessment of exactly what was going on. The report titled An Independent Report on Our Financial Deficit in 2016, a very catchy title, I know, was written by Steve Bundred, former chief exec of the National Audit Office. It was published in February 2017 and subsequently became known simply as Bundred. So let me briefly share with you some of his comments. First, an entire annual budget, 2016-17, approved on the basis of a false assumption that previously agreed cuts had been fully carried out and savings delivered, and an assumption that a balanced outturn would probably be achieved, can at best be described as artful. He said there was a tacit understanding among the senior leadership team that contentious decisions should not be asked of politicians before the May elections of 2016. He said, even those senior officers who have raised concerns with me appear to have very little awareness of what a first-class local authority looks like. And Mr. Bundred went on to conclude, saying, I'm in no doubt that the sequence of events described in this report represents a collective failure of leadership within the council, for which several people, including elected politicians, bear responsibility. Now, I would share with you that having a local authority that is competent is one of those unfairly balanced things in life. It's rarely noticed, and it doesn't fill people with joy and excitement when it's delivered. But it is certainly noticed, and people pay a heavy price when it's not, because the leaders of a place have no foundation from which to deliver. The 2018 report into the failed Northamptonshire Council said, never underestimate the importance of doing the boring well. Well, I'm delighted to be able to say tonight that in my deputy mayor, Craig Cheney, who has led on our council finances, we have someone who has become a master of doing their boring well. Thank you, Craig. Now, back to this month and the 2018 Local Government Association panel, who also, in their report, reported that they found a real sense of ambition for the city and the council, a new direction. They said, the mayor sets the tone of vision and collaboration working with external partners. They shared there was a new and impressive senior officer leadership team ready to deliver. And they pointed to a set of new values and behaviours, a change from the past. Now, of course, there remain serious challenges and areas for improvement. But in the summary, they found the council is now in a stronger position to take the critical decisions the city of Bristol needs to fulfil its exceptional potential. Now, as crucial as all that is, modern city and mayoral leadership must be about more than the local authority, because what you will receive from Bristol is not simply the result of decisions made by any single organisation. What you and all citizens experience as Bristol is the product of the combination of decisions made across local government, the NHS, the police, universities, business, voluntary community sector, faith communities. And if we're going to lead a place, we need to work as though that is true. The challenge is one of how we come together to turn what could become a chaotic mass of activity into an organised collaboration. It's in this context that Chief Constable Andy Marsh's words really cut through when he says, world-class public leadership is not about what you control, but about what you influence. The LGA peer challenge team also looked closely at our relationships with the city. Among their conclusions, they reported, you have a good understanding of Bristol as a place and the extraordinary opportunities it offers. They said developing the one city approach has shown real ambition, driven through convened and asked by the mayor and council, with partners clearly work in progress, but still much to do. Now, it's been our aim to work with the city, not against it, around it, despite it, or irrespective of it. And we are maturing into an enabling organization, making space and supporting people to get things done rather than getting caught in the bottleneck of council processes. It's an empowerment approach that recognizes that we are interdependent and requires the council to be more than a mere provider of services and become a development partner. President Barack Obama said, the strongest democracy flourishes from frequent and lively debate, but endures when people of every background and belief find a way to set aside smaller differences in service of a greater purpose. Now, we are setting aside smaller differences to focus on collective delivery. We are working with city partners towards a One City plan, driving forward a jointly shaped One City vision for 2050 that will bring focus to what we do. The plan will enable us to pursue the Bristol we want to be, rather than being on the back foot trying to make best of whatever opportunity or challenge happens our way. A perfect example of the collaboration is the work between the Mayor's Office, Bristol and Bath Regional Capital and Quartet. In the spring, we will launch a city fund that could generate millions of pounds of ethical investment and provide a platform for benefactors to step forward in support of their own city. This shows a real scale of ambition to transform the city, and the board is already progressing hunger programmes, community cohesion and economic inclusion. And I'd say it's this scale of collaboration that presents the city the real opportunity to move beyond the shallow analysis and short-termism driven by the party politics played out in the council chamber and on the pages of our local press. This is the stuff of substance, in contrast to the political gestures and symbolism we've regularly seen. The work we are doing will survive me and will open a door for future leaders to work with the city. 2020 will be a good time to get elected. The winner will inherit a city plan, a structure and a culture of collective city leadership tuned to delivery. And I might add, they will also inherit a solvent local authority. These achievements offer to fundamentally change the city by changing the way it is led. Now, those are real achievements, but I know I will primarily get measured against my own pledges to the city as set out for the election of 2016. So let's turn to these. Now, Harold Wilson said a week is a long time in politics, and that is true, but it's also true that 4 years is too short to deliver the scale of programme we have been putting together. Political leadership is like trying to drive a car at 100 miles an hour while servicing the engine, laying the tarmac, and reading the map. This is especially so in light of the challenges we inherited. It doesn't make the headlines, but it's critical to put the building blocks in place for future success. So I made 7 pledges to the city. So in the absence of our own midterm elections, take what follows as my own midterm report. Pledge 1. We will build 2,000 new homes, 800 affordable a year by 2020. This is our number one priority, and we are doing pretty well. Even Mark Weston, Councillor Mark Weston, the leader of the opposition in Bristol, acknowledged this. And in Bristol, where we live in a world of political point scoring, you know you're getting something right when the official opposition says you are. My favourite Post headline this year was, "Marvin set to smash his housing target." And as that article referenced, 2,000 homes per year and 800 affordable by 2020 was always ambitious, but we are on track to deliver in full. With no existing affordability programme in place, we had a standing start. But in this year, we expect to complete 1,886 homes with 271 affordable. In 2019-20, we expect to complete 2,308 market rate homes with 499 affordable. And by the target year of 2020, we expect to build 1,533 market rate homes, 916 affordable. Working with my cabinet colleague, Paul Smith, last week around 100 developers and investors gathered at the M-Shed for the launch of our new Bristol Is perspective, which sets out our development ambitions, and there are copies at the back. They came because they recognised we are a city that at long last is getting homes built. And they have bought into our commitment on building affordable homes in mixed communities in an inclusive economy. Now, there are plenty who want to come on that journey with us. We welcome that. Of course, there are also those who just want to turn up, make a fast buck, and not invest in the city's common good and its people. And I promise you, they'll find themselves at the back of the city's queue. But as part of our ambitions in this area, we've launched our own housing company. This is another tool that will enable us to build houses where the market doesn't provide the right solutions and reinvest profits in affordable and social housing. And because of the scale of the housing challenge and because we need the courage to reimagine and rethink, we are launching a 5-year housing festival this week on Waterfront Square. Now, please visit The houses are going up there right now next to the Lloyds Amphitheatre. You will experience some of the latest innovations in technology offering step change in the way we do housing. The festival is being led by Jez Sweetland in partnership with ourselves, Homes England and the Shaftesbury Partnership. It's focusing the world's attention on Bristol. Pledge 2, we will deliver work experience and apprenticeships for every young person. Now, the opportunity for young people to have a meaningful experience of work is a key factor in setting a life trajectory. And it's shocking that 56% of our young people were not getting access to work experience in 2016. The proverb says it takes a village to raise a child. I want to build on that to say it would take a whole city to meet this challenge. That's why in 2017 we launched Bristol Works Initiative. We're matching employers offering work experience with young people searching for opportunity. Last year, 51 employers came forward and 2,477 young people benefited. Bristol's Learning City Partnership enables collaborative working between employers, universities, colleges, schools on issues such as development of skills and careers guidance, tailored experiences of work, and is all being led by my cabinet lead, Councillor Anna Keane, whose father was actually my secondary school teacher too. So a nice poetic turn of events for us all there. Now, Bristol is also now one of 5 national apprenticeship diversity hubs, working to create an increasingly diverse workforce. And next week, there is a You're Hired event planned in the gallery, so much more positive than the You're Fired culture propagated by television. This year, 6,000 job seekers have attended a jobs fair or advice day. And I'll add too that we have 3 programmes to better improve the diversity of our city's talent pipelines. Future Bright, providing in-work career development for people living in council housing. Stepping Up, a BME talent development programme expanding to women and disabled people in the coming year. And the City Leadership Programme, investing in the futures of high ability, high aspiration young people from disadvantaged social and economic backgrounds. And we are proud also to have become the first council in the country to ban the box on our application process, opening up employment avenues for ex-offenders. Now, I just want to point out that all this work is about more than social justice. It's in the city's self-interest not to leave talent on the shelf. Pledge 3, we will stop expansion of RPZs and review existing schemes. Now, residential parking schemes were the flavour of the campaign in 2016, and so each candidate took a turn in having a pledge. We delivered the review, putting councillors at the forefront, and we remain open to changes should ward councillors demonstrate overwhelming support for their proposals in the community. But even as I made the pledge, I saw it as a byproduct of the poor quality of political discourse and the absence of political vision at that time. I've carried out the pledge in full, but it in no way reflects our transport priorities. No administration for years has taken transport seriously. There have been efforts to improve cycling and walking, but it remains difficult to travel from A to B. Communities in areas such as Hartcliffe, Avonmouth and Hillfields remain disconnected. Congestion adversely impacts on the city's economy and air quality. We will not repeat the errors of recent years in pretending that cars will disappear if we make life difficult for car drivers, nor will we ignore the economic impact when we do transport planning. We will have an impact on congestion and on people movement by presenting real choice. We must generate mass transit options that are better, cheaper, and easier than car travel. Now, thanks to the efforts of my cabinet lead, Vari Threfel, we have our Bristol Transport Strategy out to consultation, outlining our vision in 2036. We have seen the biggest single order of biogas buses in the UK, and we are leading the way on smart ticketing, contactless payments. 7 out of 10 passengers now board the bus using these payment methods. The key outcomes of the congestion task group are being implemented, including the creation of a transport board that will bring key city transport partners to work more closely with the City Council for future planning. But most importantly, we have a flight path for a phased growth of public transport. The first strand of that growth will be looking at a new deal for bus use. And I can share tonight that we are in the process of working towards a heads of agreement that sets out a joint relationship based on long-term and sustained public-private investment in the bus system. Working with our partners in the west of England, the aim of the agreement will be to double bus usage to 20% of all journeys through enhanced service frequencies on the core network, doubling the frequency on main routes, greater service stability through increased enforcement of bus lanes and highway improvements, the use of new technology to inform where services are most delayed, extension of the quality and frequency of services into less well-served area, and a single flat fare zone covering the whole city. Because of Bristol's geography, the less affluent parts of the city on the outer town estates currently pay more than the wealthy areas to travel to and from the city centre. First Bus and ourselves has agreed that we will work towards a standard fare across the city, bringing equality to bus travel. Now, I announced our ambitions for a new mass transit system for Bristol on this night last year, and you would have seen illustrations in the video. I can say the first feasibility study was positive, and we will get the results of the second, more advanced study in December. Now, at this point, I should be clear that what we are talking about before anyone publishes their own version of the London Underground map. We are not talking about the London Tube with 200-metre-long trains. A key element of what makes it possible and quicker to deliver is that we may not even need rails or track. Some automated systems around the world just run by following a simple white line painted on the floor. But we are clearly planning for a segregated mass transit system using tunnels and infrastructure appropriate for Bristol's future needs. Pledge 4, we will protect children's centres. And we have. And it's been a triumph of city leadership and Labour values in the face of Conservative austerity. We invested £1.8 million in remodelling children's services to keep them open. And we launched the Children's Charter, which is in the foyer here tonight, for which I thank Councillor Helen Godwin, my Cabinet Lead for Children's Services. The Charter is the city's first set of aspirations for children, clearly laid out with a delivery plan for each. Over 20 organisations, as well as families and children across the city, signed up their support for the Charter at the Bristol Play Day in August. And last week, Jeremy Corbyn signed it too. The Charter sets out a commitment to every child, irrespective of their background. It recognises the fact that what children receive from our city is one of the surest measures of our true city values. And although we didn't pledge it, our Better Lives programme is transforming the most under-pressure area of adult social care, led by my Cabinet Lead, Helen Holland. The programme keeps people in their homes longer and makes the service more efficient. Pledge 5, we will increase the number of school places and introduce a fair admissions process. Now, we've secured a site in Temple Quarter for what will be Bristol's biggest secondary school, and we are working with partners for a new school in Lotleys, while expanding existing schools for more places. 3 years ago, Bristol was ranked the worst for school attendance in the whole of the UK. We set out improvements, and only last week we held a summit at City Hall with over 100 education partners sharing best practice and developing a strategy that includes robust guidance on mental health, support, and a focus on vulnerable children. Pledge 6, we will put Bristol on course to be run entirely on clean energy by 2050 and introduce a safe, clean streets campaign. Now, a very exciting outcome of working towards this pledge has been the launch of the City Leap. That's a £1 billion package of projects that will transform the way Bristol generates, stores and utilises energy. We went to market for expressions of interest and had 180 submissions from investors across the UK and around the world, including the Japanese National Bank and Warren Buffett's Berkshire Hathaway investment vehicle. We've been installing district heat systems, placing new insulation measures in 20,000 council properties, and have launched fuel poverty projects across the city. On clean streets, we've mobilised over 3,000 volunteers and introduced fines for littering, with over 10,000 being issued to date. Pledge 7, we will lead a European Capital of Culture bid to make culture and sport accessible to all. Now, post the Brexit vote to leave the European Union, it was clear to us that investing large amounts of money and time in bidding for the European Capital of Culture would be a fruitless venture. But, well, glad you like that one. But Councillor Estella Ticknell saw another opportunity. As well as her ongoing work with the cultural sector to develop the city's cultural strategy, she identified the opportunity to bid to become a UNESCO City of Film, and we were successful. More recently, I brought together the media and creative sectors, and we worked together to pitch for Channel 4's relocation. And we've been shortlisted in the final six for one of the two creative hubs that are going to be, and the results will be announced at the end of this month. And we've taken a similar approach to bid for Netflix, who we have found out are looking for new UK bases. And we're looking at what we can do to position Bristol as a hub for production studios, a real opportunity in the creative marketplace. We committed to funding phase two of the Colston Hall redevelopment, saving this key cultural hub in the city, as well as supporting successful developments of St George's and the Bristol Old Vic. On sport, I like to quote my cabinet lead, Kai Dudd, who said, "This is without doubt the most pro-sport administration the city has ever seen." And he's right. We continue to work with our professional clubs and the sporting sector to bring world-class sporting events, grow participation, and develop elite athletes from amongst our own city population. Now, of course, my midterm report is positive, but I wrote it. So you'd expect it to be so. Give me that grace, right? Let's put that aside, though. But you can test it by looking at the city, talking to partners, and actually going out and reading the reports I've been citing this evening. Beyond the pledges, though, is a whole raft of major plans we are delivering. We're reworking the Bristol local plan, led by my cabinet lead, Nicola Beach. It's a blueprint for future land use, finding space for the additional 33,500 new homes and employment land the city needs. Jobs and affordable housing are at its heart, as is the importance of maintaining community and diverse economies. Consultation is planned for early next year, but we've already had some very helpful early responses highlighted to me through Twitter. Local campaigner Matthew Montague Pollock said, "I know from my own experience that there's no way that towers provide an equivalent quality of life to a house or a mid-rise flat with a communal garden," and then qualified that statement by saying, "Our mayor came from a poor background, looked up and saw the high rises of London and Manchester and thought that is the answer. Aspirational cities build high." But he carefully adds, "But that is an uneducated answer." Well, thanks for your input, Matthew. I'll take that on board. And on this stage last year, I announced the development of the Western Harbour that will expand the city centre to the west, creating a new residential district. It will deliver over 2,500 new homes in a mixed-use development. Planning work is now underway for the replacement of the ageing and outdated roads and bridges with a new transport layout that will include the moving of the bridge or possibly even replacing it with a tunnel. Towns and city centres are changing rapidly as shopping habits, leisure pursuits, work patterns and travel choices continue to evolve. These challenges present a threat but also an opportunity to remodel and reshape the city centre to make sure it serves the city's aspirations. We've pulled together a working group of city partners and investors determined to secure the city centre. And I've asked them to work with the leaders of all major developments, including the airport, Temple Meads, and the university. We must ensure we are ahead of the curve if we are going to keep Bristol as a retail and leisure hub, both for the daytime and nighttime economies. For future city centres to stay alive, we need to bring people to them, and our planning will be centred around mixed developments, including retail, entertainment, affordable homes, and jobs. And we continue to work towards the redevelopment of Temple Meads. We have appointed a multidisciplinary team led by Mott MacDonald. This will allow us and partners to master plan this city gateway, unlock development in the surrounding area, and support neighbouring projects, including the university campus and the Temple Island development. This work, I should point out, also supports our £250 million housing infrastructure bid. And of course, we need cohesive communities. Returning to the recent LGA review I mentioned earlier, it said, "We see a council developing a new conversation with its communities." And I must say, I'm delighted that my Deputy Mayor, Asher Craig, is leading that conversation. We're committed to our communities and supporting them to flourish. We are working with Paul Hassan and others on how we use the council's land and property assets to address inequality and disadvantage, changing the way we procure and commission services to strengthen our network of community anchors. We're harnessing the efforts of key partners from across the city, partners including Locality, Vosca and Quartet, as well as funding agencies such as Bristol and Bath Regional Capital and Power to Change, alongside the city's business community, who are all investing in the capacity of these community organisations. Together, we are developing community-led housing, community enterprise, infrastructure, and space to tackle public health and education and skills needs. Now, I want to mention a few people in particular. Alex Kitto and his team in Southmead, who are working on the Glencoyne Square project. Mark Pepper at Ambition Lawrence Weston for his locally designed housing and renewable energy. Joanna Holmes and the Barton Hill Settlement team providing better services in partnership with the Wellspring Centre. Caroline Hassan in Knowle West driving innovative approaches to housing, manufacturing and digital inclusion. The Philwood Community Centre and their low carbon hub. Steve Sayers with new social enterprises at Windmill Hill City Farm. And we are truly, as a city, privileged to have so many great people here. Our challenge as a local authority is to get out of their way and support them to get done what they want to get done. And I must mention the arena. It's been an issue for the last few months, you probably noticed. Now, having completed a value for money review, I made the decision not to proceed with the arena on Temple Island. So let me take this opportunity to set out how that decision was made. Because the decision we actually had to make was for the best use of Temple Island. And the evidence showed us that the alternative mixed-use development put £500 million more into the economy over 25 years and generated three times as many jobs as the arena. A Temple Island arena would have paid £400,000 a year in business rates. The mixed-use development will pay approximately £3 million a year in business rates and council tax combined, essential to the future financial viability of this local authority. The floor transport plan would have brought 3,500 cars each sell-out night into Temple Meads with nowhere to park. The arena was too small to bring world-class acts and to qualify as world-class, and the proximity of the Temple Island Arena to the train station has been identified as a security liability. The Temple Island Arena could only be delivered with £150 million of public debt that we would have to repay. The arena was a perfect example of a flawed political discourse in the city. It was a discourse that wrapped itself around a binary choice between like-for-like options that never really existed, because each option came with dramatically different levels of risk and financial consequences for the council and the city. Someone once said that the problems start when people see decisions as two choices, when most see the answer as somewhere in the middle. If there are people who want to exploit this and put the public money and the level of public risk to one side, they're doing so for political gain, not for the good of our city. If there are people who see it as a totemic issue to campaign or even stand for election on, as some are clearly launching their campaigns early and using this issue, then they are selling the city short. We have complex challenges, and social media commentators want to promote unrealistically simplistic options. We don't have that luxury in leadership and must make evidence-based decisions driven by inclusive economic growth and fairness. Now, our international work and profile has been supporting the growth of trade and investment in the city and building our reputation as an internationally significant city. Last year, I announced I would bring the Global Parliament of Mayors to Bristol. And this week, we will host over 80 mayors and the world's leading city networks, coming together to drive the development of national and international policy on migration, urban health and security. And we will, of course, be showcasing Bristol and the UK's key industries. All of this is essential as we navigate the government's mismanagement of Brexit. And as part of our work in that area, I'm really pleased to be able to announce tonight that we will be funding the costs of any of our own employees at Bristol City Council who wish to seek EU settled status. And I would encourage other employers in Bristol to join with us in that commitment. Also, drawing on Bristol's diversity and internationalism, I have invited some key Bristol figures to become our first official city international ambassadors. These are people who already travel the world in their line of work promoting the city. But as official Bristol ambassadors, we will add to their ability to represent our city to different international audiences. So if I can ask you to indicate where you are if you're here tonight, I have invited well-known local artist DJ Bungie, also known as Ivor Anderson, Noah West Media Centre's innovative chief executive Caroline Hassan, and Bristol's boxing legend Chris Saniger. I'm going to take a risk and ask if they're here. Chris, do you mind taking a stand? You've got to stand. And I really am proud to know that people like that will be representing us on the international stage, again, drawing from the grassroots and the fullness of our great city. So as I've laid out tonight, this city is changing, and together we are making real progress. We have grown trust with the government. Several different government departments tell us Bristol has been a basket case for decades, and they now feel that we are focused on delivery and they can do business with us. We have built trust with our city partners, with community groups, and with investors who want to work with us. We have built trust with the universities and schools, our business and unions. And by delivering on our promises and transformation of the city, then we are building trust with our citizens. We are taking decisions with responsibility. It's because of our financial responsibility and our fiscal management that we are able to deliver. And by balancing the budget and a smart use of reserves, we've been able to avoid implementing the big cuts, have kept children's centres open, will keep libraries open, and have kept and are starting to improve key services. Many of my political opponents treat public money like monopoly money. I don't. Council taxpayers often struggle to pay that bill. When you have a choice of paying your council tax, putting food on the table, or money on the electric key, then you deserve to have that money treated with respect. And this administration is alone among the political players in Bristol in taking that approach. By cutting £1 million from council's senior management costs, refusing to use public money on vanity projects, and by prioritising adults, families and children, our responsible approach to city management means we can deliver on our promises and our pledges. And finally, we are making changes in a city where the public narrative for decades has been nothing gets done. This was recognised by the LGA review team, who noted, if the council builds upon the foundations it is establishing, then such perceptions will be replaced by belief, hope, and trust in the council and its leadership. And it will lead to real change for Bristol. We are now delivering with a council leadership dedicated to delivery and responsive to the elected priorities. Delivering with the council and city partners working together for a common aim for the first time ever. Delivering with people like you who are here tonight because you care about our city. Delivering because instead of playing political games and focusing on personal attacks, we are focusing on the things that matter for Bristol. No one can change a city on their own. The council alone cannot deliver change, deliver inclusive growth, close the inequality gap, deliver services, volunteer, or make a difference. We will only make that difference by pulling together. And I have had enough of people talking down our city. With an attitude of hope and collaboration to common goals, we will deliver. We are building a city where nobody gets left behind. Together, we are building a city of hope. Thank you for your time this evening.